life of Ned Kelly ended here at the old Melbourne jail in 1880. But his legend had only just begun. Ned could never have imagined that more than 100 years after his death, he could still hold a nation in awe. This is the world premiere of Gregor Jordan's Ned Kelly. Just two blocks from where Ned was hanged, a huge crowd has gathered to celebrate Ned's story in its latest incarnation. Ned has become part of Hollywood. With international stars like Heath Ledger, Naomi Watts, Jeffrey Rush, and Orlando Bloom taking roles in a story that has helped shape Australia's identity.
Well, Ned Kelly is an important part of our cultural heritage. You know, he's sort of, in a way, defining of who we are as Australians.
I'll certainly take a piece of Ned with me. He's certainly going to be carried around inside my heart and mind for a long time, and the family, and just what he stood for, and it's given me the courage to stand up and be true to what I believe in.
He fits the mold of the highwayman hero, romantic outlaw, altogether too perfectly.
Over the years, there have been hundreds of different interpretations of who Ned Kelly was and what he represented.
My God!
It's
Ned Kelly!
It's me, Ned Kelly!
I'm not Ned Kelly, sir.
But I am.
Can I help you?
Yes, you can. My name's Edward Kelly.
His mates call him Ned.
Ned Kelly? I'm sure I've heard that name somewhere.
I'm sure you have, sir.
Even before his death, Ned Kelly had become a celebrity. He and his gang had an £8,000 bounty on their heads, the largest reward ever offered to that time. The entire nation and many other parts of the British Empire knew the name of the brash outlaw. And like today, that name could attract a crowd. Only hours after Ned Kelly's execution, members of his family took to the stage to tell their story.
Kate Kelly and Jim Kelly, they wanted to put their brother's case, and an entrepreneur just persuaded them to go on stage the night of the execution. And it was a sad, ill-advised thing to do, but they did it.
The police, already wary of Kelly's legacy, shut the show down. But the legend could not be contained. In 1906, pioneering filmmaker Charles Tate created his own version of the legend, The Story of the Kelly Gang, which was one of the world's first feature films.
In 1906, that was only 26 years after Ned was hanged, and so a lot of the people involved in the story would have still been alive at that time, so it would have been topical. And the interesting thing about the film is that even though it's very scratchy and grainy and deteriorated and there's only about 11 minutes remaining, you know exactly what's going on. You can see exactly who the characters are. You can see who's Ned. You can see who's Dan. You can recognise Fitzpatrick.
It was strongly pro-Kelly, and it showed Ned in a very attractive light. He was good-looking, muscular, well-dressed, and it was enormously well-received.
Audiences cheered when Ned appeared on screen and booed the police. The immense popularity of the film began to concern the government, and in 1912 it was banned due to fears it would inspire criminal activity. This didn't stop filmmakers from bringing Ned to the screen. The prolific Harry Southwell wrote, directed and produced three Kelly films over 14 years, beginning in 1920 with The Kelly Gang. Southwell initially avoided the band by portraying the police in a heroic manner. Here we see Sergeant Kennedy saying goodbye to his wife and child before heading off to pursue Ned. Despite the attempts to portray Ned as a villain, his image grew as an outlawed hero who railed against injustice. The Kelly legend was further developed from the 1940s when Sidney Nolan, one of Australia's most celebrated artists, began his striking series of paintings portraying Ned's story. His paintings reduced the outlaw to a broad black helmet and armour, an instantly recognisable image. While Nolan helped move Ned into the world of high culture, his role as a movie star continued with the 1951 production of The Glen Rowan Affair. The film starred Bob Chitty, famous not for his acting abilities, but as a tough Australian rules footballer.
What the devil is it, Ned? Where did you get it?
I found it asleep in the bathtub.
You'll pay for this, whoever you are.
Now, surely you recognise us.
They're the Kellys, sir.
One of the funny things about Bob Chitty is, you know, he looks like he was probably in his early to mid-30s, but Ned was only 25 when he died.
When Kelly next appeared on film, his image as a middle-aged man would be shattered, thanks to a bold casting decision that would bring Ned into the age of rock and roll.
When scarcely 16 years of age...
Mick Jagger may not have had Ned's stature, but at 27 he was closer to Ned's real age than previous actors who had portrayed the bushranger.
Sir, credit to ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Kelly. I must say, you're much better looking than we'd be led to believe. But why does such a young man wear a beard?
My mother used to say, Mrs. Scott, that kissing a man without a beard was like eating porridge without salt. You eat porridge without salt, Mrs. Scott?
Oh, never, Mr. Kelly.
Excuse me.
Someone called old Jim Devine.
When I first saw Mick, which was at the filming of the execution scene, I was shocked that he had a beard and no moustache. The Jagger mouth, that trademark mouth, was blazing out. He was portraying Ned as a very young man, and as a man with an Irish accent. For that, I was grateful. You had his youth, you had his Irishness, right up there up front. And those are two essential truths of the Kelly story, which are frequently lost.
What do you want?
It's about your bull. I found it straying on my property. I've taken him to the pound. Perhaps you might like to recommend me to be a member of your Stock Protection Society.
The very flesh of men. Well, the sooner you take the flashness out of him, the better.
Jagger helped make Ned Kelly a name that was recognised internationally.
The newspapers have called me a murderer, but my conscience is as clear as the snow in Peru.
But in Australia, the film became simply another piece in the already enormous collection of Kelly culture. Over the years, hundreds of books, poems, films, plays, even operas and ballets have been written about Ned, and the figure continues to grow. Ned Kelly has become hot property, and it seems his image can sell anything from T-shirts to tea towels. But the most sought-after items are the original artifacts that Kelly left behind. The gang's armour is safely preserved, as is the sash he received for saving young Dick Shelton.
And the sash is in a tiny little museum in Benalla, and it still exists. It's in there in a glass case, and you can still see the bloodstains on it. And there's something so incredibly moving about seeing that sash, because this was, you know, a present that was given to Ned when he was a 10-year-old boy for saving a kid from drowning. You know, it was basically the greatest moment in his life.
Along with the sash and the armour, another important Kelly artefact is the Gerildery letter. A 56-page document dictated to Joe Byrne, outlining Ned's grievances.
You know, I'd read his Gerildery letter quite a few times and just how passionate he was in there and so definite and precise and how sure he was about his cause.
I give fair warning to all those who have reason to fear me not to attempt to reside in Victoria. Neglect this and abide by the consequences, which shall be worse than the rust in the wheat. I do not wish to give this order full force without timely warning, but I am a widow's son, outlawed. My orders must be obeyed.
After 120 years, interest in Ned Kelly is stronger than ever. His status as an Australian cultural icon was underlined when he starred in the opening ceremony of the 2000 Sydney Olympic Games. The following year, Peter Carey's The True History of the Kelly Gang won the prestigious Booker Prize, while Robert Drew's novel Our Sunshine formed the basis of the screenplay for Gregor Jordan's Ned Kelly. As the success of the film demonstrates, interest in Kelly shows no sign of abating.
It's Ned.
Neddy!
Ned's life might have been a short one, but it seems a man who has become a legend never truly dies.
I don't think Ned's going to go away, because the further we get from the Kelly period, the more remarkable men like this become.
My film of Ned Kelly, I don't pretend to be a defining portrayal. It's an interpretation, and what I hope is that people will see the film and it will spark an interest and inspire them to go and read up and go and see the sash and go and see the armour, and make up their own mind about who the guy was.